Jeff Lafferty, and today I'm not going to look at myself because I make funny faces in that in the window when I look at myself. Anyway, today it's time for another episode of Back to the Drawing Board podcast, where I talk about art and the business of art. And today I got a great show for you guys. David Petersen, the creator of Mouse Guard, came on for an interview, and it's a great interview. He has a ton of good stuff about, you know, being a working artist, you know, surviving, you know, just in the whole realm of printed books and all, that whole kind of thing. And also, you know, he kind of lets us in on a little bit, you know, of the behind the curtain stuff of like how he makes a living. And it's got a lot to do with him selling stuff himself, which I thought was pretty interesting. So anyway, we'll get going with that. A couple things I want to talk about first. Don't forget about the contest. Giving away this card at the end of March, and all you got to do to win it is just share one of my videos. It doesn't have to be this one, any of them. Share them on your social media. And a couple other things. Got the new Godzilla print in the store, and also the new Mad Max print. So check those out. If you want them, pick them up. I'd appreciate it. And here we go. David, oh, there's my airbrush again. Always running. Anyway, let's get going with the interview. David Petersen of Mouse Guard. Thanks for coming on the show, David.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Okay. Yeah, I love Mouse Guard. I'm a big fan of it. So I you know, I've kind of fell off of comics. I don't go to the comic shops that much, but eventually I found your blog online, and I thought it was really cool because, you know, you were still doing it and everything. So how long have you had that blog?
I think I started it in like 2009, but it was only a couple of years ago that I took it to being a full once a week style update. I was just updating whenever I felt like I had something to share, and I realized it didn't have enough traction. People never knew when to come back and check and see when there was new content or something like that. And I just thought, if I make this a regular thing, if I make sure that I'm sharing the right kind of material, if the blog posts have real content, it'll make a difference.
Yeah, you definitely do it right. I mean, I follow a lot of different comics creators' blogs, and you know, some of them are just so lame that, you know, they just never post anything, and then you'll wait and wait, and eventually they'll put up a post like, "Hey, I'm going to be at WonderCon," you know. You're just like, "Oh."
Yeah. Yeah.
But you write like lots and lots of good stuff and put up like a lot of really cool art that you know, I had never seen before of your stuff.
Thanks.
Yeah.
I worried about also doing the update, you know, just making it like an advertisement kind of a thing. So I always wanted to make sure that I was sharing something about my process, something that you couldn't get somewhere else.
Right. How did you, I mean, let's kind of go back and start from the beginning. I mean, how did you get interested in comics in the first place?
I had liked comics, you know, when I was a kid, middle school, high school era. I think the Ninja Turtles were my first real introduction to comics, where I thought like, oh, people make these.
Yeah.
As opposed to, I mean, I was reading some X-Men stuff, and those were cool. And even though I saw the names of the various creators who worked on those issues, it just didn't completely sink in until I saw Eastman and Laird's name on their own book that was, you know, totally unlike anything else.
Yeah.
That I went, oh, these are like real people. Like, this is a job that you can have. You can make comics.
Right.
So friends and I spent a lot of time making up comics. We were a pretty tight-knit group. A lot of us were artists. Some of us were writers. And we did role-playing together. We played other games together. We tried to make little home movie films together.
Mm.
And it was just a whole lot of creativity.
And that was kind of like in high school?
Yeah, that was middle school, high school.
That's cool. Were you in on the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles kind of like when they first started, like the black and white comics, or did you find them later?
I was in on the stuff. Hey, Jeff.
Hello, yeah.
Sorry about
No problem.
The internet just totally cut out there for a minute. I don't know what happened.
Oh, I hope it's not going to be one of those nights. Yeah, that's what it said. It said you were not only off Skype, but you were completely offline, so.
Yeah.
Okay. So I hope all this works, and I hope I've got everything that we just recorded, but we're not that far into it. Anyway, you were talking about, the guys at Image, and saying that they were kind of your influences when you were younger, and also kind of why that's changed, because you really draw quite a bit different than that.
Yeah, I mean, while those guys were influences, and you know, even Jim Lee was doing something different with Wildcats than what was going on over it with the X-Men, it still was kind of mainstream, comparatively. And it was things like Hellboy and The Mask that opened my eyes into actual indie books again after the Turtles.
Yeah, so that kind of like brings you over to that kind of side. I'm sorry, I'm just trying to get my windows open, distracting me. Anyway, one thing you said that kind of like I got to go back to it, because you know you said you and your friends were doing like home movies and stuff back in the day.
Yeah.
Do you do any of that stuff anymore?
No.
Really?
No. We always toyed. In fact, even then we didn't really do it. We talked a lot about things.
Yeah.
And starting movies, and I'd start going into pre-production for costumes and all the kind of props and sets and things like that. But no, I don't think we ever got anything filmed that was longer than about 5 minutes.
Yeah.
And it was all terrible.
Well, it's tough when you were a kid, you know.
Yeah. We just it was more that it was just a creative outlet. We were always thinking about storytelling. For a while, we were remaking movies that already existed.
Mm-hmm.
So we were taking things like Back to the Future was one that we tried doing ourselves. The Ninja Turtles.
Yeah.
Rocketeer was another one.
Oh,
and
cool.
It was really just an excuse to try to make those costumes, I think. And it wasn't until later that we started thinking about our own material and how to do something unique.
Yeah. I used to have a Super 8, me and my friends did the same kind of thing. You know, we shot little short films, and I remember, you know, shooting like the part of Raiders of the Lost Ark, you know, where he was dragging under the truck and all that kind of stuff, you know.
Yeah.
It's just so much fun, but we didn't get anything ever accomplished with it either, you know.
Yeah.
Nowadays, I've kind of got into like stop motion and all that, and I couldn't help but notice some of these awesome things you put on your blog of the miniatures that you create. You know, the miniature. I don't know if they're just for reference or what, but
it's for reference. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, talk a little bit about that. I mean, why did you start doing that?
I started doing the models for reference. They're models of set pieces from Mouse Guard locations, and I started doing those because I was having a hard time drawing the same location over and over without some kind of reference. I mean, at first I was using photo reference, so I'd find some building and then use photos of it. But I'd only have, you know, photos from a certain angle, and then after that, you know, I'm stinkered. I don't have any more reference. I don't know what the other side of that thing looks like, or I'll have to, even if I know what it looks like, I have to figure it all out in terms of perspective and drawing it.
Yeah.
So I just started building my own models of things to help with all the geometry, and then also for the design. I was doing a library set, and I sat there for, I don't know, 2-3 hours trying to draw something. Because I knew what I wanted the library to look like, sort of. I wanted it to be based on this real library in Ireland that I had visited.
Yeah.
But it's also the library that is the inspiration for the Jedi library, or the Jedi archive in the second Star Wars movie.
Yeah.
And so it was really easy for it just to start to look like that again. And I didn't want the reference to be quite so obvious, and I just kept drawing something like it got to the point where I was drawing a line and then erasing it because I'd say that looks too much like the Jedi Temple.
Hmm.
You know, I like just one line. I haven't even made anything yet, and I just go, nope, too much like the Jedi Temple already. so, So instead of trying to fake it, with the and struggle through the drawing part, I just I got out some cardboard and tried I thought, what if I make one of the columns? If I just make one of the columns, that'll do it.
Yeah.
And then I can draw the rest. And then once I made that first column out of cardboard, figuring out the proportions of the rest of the building was all in scale with that. So I was just holding up other pieces of cardboard and going, okay, well, the next arch would be about this size, or the, you know, the width of the room would be, you know, be about this size based on the size of this one column I made. And then I realized if I just did a little bit more work to flesh out the piece so that it could be photographed, I could just photograph it over and over and over down the length of a table and make a whole room out of it.
Right.
And that was kind of the genesis of, okay, now this is what I'm doing. This makes sense. It made things much easier. I was able to design and photograph an entire building in probably 2 hours instead of the probably two plus that it took me to get absolutely nowhere with, erasing and erasing and erasing.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, how crazy do you get with that? I mean, do you have, like, the whole mouse guard world kind of built down your hallway and down your stairs? And
I have a lot of, I am running out of shelf space.
That's cool. I think that, yeah, once you kind of start going down that road, I notice I'm the same way. It just, you know, just gets out of control. And plus, it's fun to build miniature sets and stuff.
It is. It is. It's also, it's a nice vacation mentally from the regular stuff that I always do. You know,
right.
Drawing and inking and coloring, and it's nice to be able to use my hands to do something that isn't just making lines on paper, and to rotate something around in 3D. It exercises a different part of my brain. It uses a different skill set. I have to make sure that the model is accessible from different angles. I have to almost make it like a film set where walls can pull away so that I can look at it from this vantage point and that vantage point. And that takes a little bit of engineering, so there's a bit of a brain teaser challenge in it for me.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, so when you get into going, like, and you're starting to build 3D stuff, I mean, do you step, I mean, because you said, like, the initial inspiration was kind of the Jedi library, but I mean, do you kind of step away from that, or do you pull out more reference to kind of, like, you know, figure out how to build columns and stuff, or are you just going straight out of your imagination at that point?
I'll do a little of both. You know, I'll pull up a column or two and then put the reference away so that I'm making sure I'm not just copying.
Right.
And then I'll do the same kind of thing with photos and stuff. Like I'll use photos to almost act like a skin on my models.
Oh, okay.
Like how in 3D modeling, you know, you have a skin.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I'm doing that and using photographs or things that I've laid out in Photoshop. And sometimes they're photos that I've taken of actual architectural elements, arches and columns and things like that. But I'll edit it down so that I'm maybe repeating the pattern differently, I'm changing the proportions of things, I'm putting a different capital on the top than there was for real. So I'm still doing a lot of editing, and then once all that's done, I still have to draw this thing. And there's an element of drawing it that, you know, my line work is taking over and making it something even different than what the model looks like.
Yeah. You know, like, just kind of like, that. This is a, you know, the animator in me kind of like wondering about this. But I mean, do you kind of like, when you're talking about like building those sets and using like textures and stuff like that, I mean, are you talking about like maybe kind of like taking pictures and doing that in Photoshop, or actually maybe taking, you know, printing out textures like rock texture and like gluing it down on the piece?
It's usually something, it's architectural based. Usually it's columns or arches. It's surface detail to architecture. I don't get into putting like wood grain on wood things and... And that type of thing. Unless it's a pattern that needs to be repeated, like tile, like a tile floor, I would do.
Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah, that's a great idea, actually. That's a good one. Let's see. I mean, what about, like, as far as photo reference in, you know, like, actually drawing mouse guard and stuff? It doesn't look like you're using a lot of photo reference, but, I mean, do you is that part of your kind of just your normal illustration style?
I don't for the mice, but beyond that, I do.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, yeah. Just because of the, I always want the mice to be expressive, and so there's an element of I can't go too far making them real mice. I have to leave a little bit of emotive quality there. They have to stand up and walk on their hind legs, and wield weapons and all of that kind of stuff. So if I go too far and make them too real, it doesn't work.
Yeah.
But for the other animals, I want the threat to always feel real. I want you to think that the snake is a real snake and it's going to eat that mouse. The same with, you know, every other species there, the foxes and wolves and all that kind of stuff. So to do that, I do look at a lot of photo reference.
Okay. I mean, you have like a
or go sometimes ahead. It's direct. Sometimes it's direct poses, just because, you know, what you find online is the perfect image of a fox or a crow or a bat or whatever. But then other times you try to make them do things that they wouldn't normally do, or a pose that no one is going to have a photo of. So you have to extrapolate and just gather together different photo elements and look at the teeth and look at this and look at the nose and the eyes, and then try to draw it from a completely different angle.
Yeah, totally. You know, I noticed also on your blog, you know, you put up a lot of like illustration you do. I saw a really cool one, The Beauty and the Beast, and there was some stuff from Dark Crystal that I just thought was wow, you know, incredible. It seems to be even more detailed than like Mouse Guard. I mean, do you consider that all kind of just part of the same style, or are you trying to kind of go in a simpler direction when you're doing Mouse Guard, or maybe not?
It's just a production issue. That's a one-time image. When you're talking about like the Beauty and the Beast piece or some of those other things, those are one-time things. I don't have to keep drawing those over and over and over and worry about consistency or anything like that. And with Mouse Guard, you know, even though I'm not good about keeping a fast schedule, there is still a schedule. Things have to get done. And so if I took the amount of time I take on something like that Beauty and the Beast piece or the Dark Crystal piece, we'd never get Mouse Guard stuff. It would, and I go way too slow as it is, so I can't slow myself down. And it's also usually those pieces are bigger.
Yeah.
Usually those are much larger pieces where I can get in there and really play with line weight and texture, ink patterning and things like that. So it's a little bit different in those terms, but I don't consciously start working on one of those and go, okay, time to draw different than Mouse Guard.
Right. Well, they don't look that different. I guess I just was curious. What size do you draw the pages of Mouse Guard?
Mouse Guard pages are drawn on 12 by 12 inch Bristol. I come in a half an inch on all four sides, so the live art area is 11 by 11.
Okay. What about that Beauty and the Beast piece? How big would that be?
That's, it's like 11 by 17 or bigger.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you do everything on Bristol then?
Yeah. I mean, I sketch in a sketchbook a lot of times first, and I do a lot of blog posts about that where I'll sketch usually the different elements. Like for the Beauty and the Beast piece, I sketched Beast, and then I sketched Beauty separately on a totally different sheet.
Yeah.
And then scan them into Photoshop. And assemble it and make corrections and alterations and stuff like that. And it's the same with Mouse Guard. So I do a lot of drawing on just sketchbook paper, but the final art is always done on Bristol.
Okay. Do you, I mean, as far as the tools go, I mean, I'm assuming you're inking and stuff by hand still.
Yeah, oh yeah.
What do you use to ink with?
I'm using Copic multiliners.
Oh, okay.
It's their felt nibbed pen. For a long time, I was using these office pens, Uniball Vision. Uniball Vision Elite office pens that were roller balls.
Wow.
But I wasn't always getting the line quality I wanted. I mean, for the most part, I was, and I was getting pretty good line. A lot of people were surprised when they heard that's what I was using.
Yeah.
Getting out of them. But I didn't have quite as much play with being able to pull a line thin or push a line thick without actually going back over it or getting a different pen out to do a really thin line or something like that. And the a lot of people were suggesting that I switch to microns.
Yeah.
I had tried using microns before, and I always found that I was smashing the nibs.
Yeah.
So my wife saw an ad for Copics, and I think she saw some other people saying that, oh, Copics are really great. That's what I use. And she said, well, maybe you should try these. I thought, yeah, but they're felt nibs again. Like, we're right back to microns.
Right.
And she said, well, the ad says the nibs are indestructible and that they offer replacement nibs. So we should just try them. I was like, all right. So I gave them a shot and instantly fell in love. They were perfect.
They must be pretty cool. A lot of people have mentioned Copics to me. I've never tried them or done anything with them, but...
Yeah, I use the 0.07 nib the most. And I can get a lot of variance out of that nib.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's handy to have some of the thicker ones for some fills, so you don't always have to bust out a bottle of ink and a brush and then wash the brush. Of course, on larger fill areas, you just have to do that. You can't use a pen to fill that large area, and you'll start to get streaking and pen lines in it. But if you've got just a small area, it's nice to have something just a little bit thicker in the nib department to fill in a small black area. And I'll use some finer ones every now and then if I have a really subtle shape or line kind of coming off. It's usually around an eye, like a mouse's eye.
Mm-hmm.
It's so subtle that if I ink it just a little bit wrong, it completely changes the expression. So sometimes I'll go in with something almost too fine and build up the line so that I make sure that I get that gesture exactly the way I wanted it.
Right. What about the coloring then? Is it digital or is it...
Coloring's all digital.
Okay. Do you do the coloring? I'm sorry, I don't know that, but...
Yeah, I do.
Right.
I do. I'm a glutton for punishment.
What are you coloring, like Photoshop or...?
Yeah, and I'm using an older version of Photoshop. I'm using Photoshop 7. Pre-CS.
Right. Yeah, I still have my old version of Photoshop. It's
When you lot of people are like, Photoshop 7, they have... I don't know what they are up to on CS now.
Yeah.
I don't know if they've come out with Photoshop 7 or CS 7 yet, but I know at one point someone was like, 7? They haven't come out with 6! And I was like, this is pre-CS. And they're like, whoa, that's crazy.
Yeah.
It has all the bells and whistles I need. You know, I'm not using a lot of the other functionality. I've seen creators who are using Photoshop and using the new 3D stuff to almost do like Google SketchUp kind of things in Photoshop.
Wow.
And that's pretty slick, but I like using my handmade models. In fact, people not even knowing my Photoshop situation will say, why don't you do all your models in SketchUp? And like I mentioned earlier, the reason is because I like doing those by hand. It's a nice break. It's something for me to change my daily routine of. And there's something about holding the piece of cardboard up and saying it should be about this height in relation to this width. That's a tactile visual thing. And so in that same way that I don't need SketchUp because I like my way of doing it the old-fashioned way, I guess same with Photoshop.
Absolutely, yeah. The thing about those models is it's just way cooler when you take a picture of that on your block and then some SketchUp thing, you know?
That's true.
So you have like a lot of original art sitting around, I guess, probably from all the pages. Do you sell those online or just...
I do sell my pages, yeah. I sell them in my online store, and I take them around to conventions with me, too. Yeah, I don't have a ton of original art just laying around. There are some pieces that I've decided to keep for me that I don't want to part with. But most of that stays secured up in a portfolio. It's not even, you know, like it's out or anything. They're in a portfolio in a flat file, so they don't take up much space.
Right. So I guess let's delve into like the writing. How did you learn how to write then?
I'm still figuring that out, actually.
Haven't got it worked out.
How to write.
I mean,
the lesson that everybody is told when they start trying to make their own comics is, or to start trying to draw their own comics, is to make sure that the storytelling is clear, which means that you can read the story without having the words there. So when I started on the first issue of Mouse Guard, I did the whole thing without a script.
Oh, wow.
I just had an outline. You know I need this to happen or this to happen, but I didn't want to have a script because I didn't want to use it as a crutch.
Mm-hmm.
Able to put words in there and think like, oh, the word balloon will help describe this part. And so I did the whole first issue without a script and then went back in and only added words as they were needed in scenes that I felt really couldn't get by without. And then I was only adding the amount of words, like the bare minimum of words that I would need in any scene. Mm-hmm. That first whole series is actually a little Spartan in text because I went that way. You can see that everybody gets a little bit more verbose as the first volume goes on. And then by winter, I was writing partial scripts. I was writing scripts like within scenes. And by the time I got to my latest, The Black Axe, I was writing full scripts before I would put any pencil to page.
Hmm. Why did you switch over?
Still very much an evolution.
Mm-hmm. Why did you switch over to, like, you know, sort of, like, I mean, that way you described in the beginning there, it almost sounds like kind of like the Marvel way of writing. You know, I think a lot of those guys drew, like, Kirby and then would draw the stories, and then, you know, whoever, Stan Lee, was, like, writing the words in almost as an afterthought.
Sure.
Why did you eventually kind of switch to that, to going more full script route?
I realized that I was struggling when it came time to draw, not knowing what should come next. That sometimes I wanted the words to be able to carry something through. Sometimes I would want to juxtapose a visual against text and have two dissimilar things going together. Or you want to get the right beats. You want to know the break of where the point in the conversation is that we should look away from the characters and still be able to see them talking, but then see off in the distance the thing they're talking about.
Okay.
So unless I had a script to know, you know, the part before that cut is about this many words, the part after that is this many words, I wouldn't know where to necessarily put the cut. I felt like I was actually holding myself back. I mean, it was very freeing at first.
Yeah.
But I felt like I was holding myself back. I also felt like I wasn't describing as much about the world as I could. You know, I know exactly what the Mouse Guard world is because it's all in my head. But then it takes a fan writing a review or a fan coming up to you and asking questions or telling you how they interpreted something to realize, like, oh, they got it totally wrong, and it's not their fault. It's my fault because I'm looking in the issue and I see now through their eyes how it could be interpreted that way.
That's interesting. You know, do you get that a lot? You know, people coming up and like, reading your work in a different way than you originally like wrote it? I never thought about that.
Not as much as used to. So in the early days when I was doing the more Spartan text and looser writing, yes, I got it. And part of that was also that the series was starting out. There wasn't as much of an introduction. There wasn't as much material for people to follow back on.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I haven't had people reading the latest volume and having any dissimilar opinions about what happened from mine.
Right. That's another good point. I mean, does it get harder to write a comic, like, past the first issue, like the second issue, the third issue, because of the backstory? Does it make it easier?
It can be both. I would say the weight of the series can get a little hard. That, you know, people are expecting more.
Yeah.
I remember when I got done with the first issue of, you know, I had the first issue of Mouse Guard all done and colored, and turned into Arkea, and Mark Smiley, who was head of Arkea at the time, was asking how things were progressing on the second issue. And I said, well, it's a little daunting to write a second issue or to get a second issue going because there's all this expectation. I have to be able to follow up what I did. You know, it's that sophomore attempt problem that you see in music.
Yeah.
And he said, well, get over it and get over it quick because you're always going to have a sophomore attempt. That doesn't go away. Like, you think it goes away, but at the same time, the first issue of your next series is going to be the sophomore attempt on your second series. And then once you write a killer first issue for that, you're going to have the second issue to write. And that's just going to follow you forever. Like, the you know, first issue of Black Axe was tough because I had to set up and introduce and live up to the expectations of the first two series. And then writing the second issue was hard because the first issue went pretty well. So, yeah, you're always kind of chasing yourself, trying to make it better and live up.
Yeah, to what you did. That makes a lot of sense. I mean, so with Artesia, I mean, is Mark Smiley, is he an actually like an editor on the comic, or is he just sort of like a publisher and doesn't have anything to do with, I guess, you know?
Mark, at the time when I started with Arkea, Mark was the president of the company, and so he wasn't really any more involved than I asked him to be.
Yeah.
You know, he wasn't really involved editorially at all, other than some big decisions about is the you know, like what the page count is, or there was a point where I was talking to him about the collection, the fall collection hardcover cover image and what I was kind of thinking about doing with that, and he had some editorial there where he was like, well, why are you going to go that route? That doesn't make any sense. I think also at the time if I had said, but Mark, that's really what I want to do, I think it's important, he totally said okay. And looking back, he was completely right. I mean, I'm not I listened to what he said, and it you know, thank God I did. What he mentioned made really good sense.
Yeah.
So now he's not president of the company anymore. He's chief creative officer. And I talk to him from time to time, but it's usually almost always business now. It's something about the business side of things.
Yeah. When did you initially kind of? I mean, did you? I mean, I think you've probably been with Artesia from the beginning, right?
Arkea.
Arkea. I'm sorry.
That's okay. I had been with Arkea since almost their beginning. Mark started Arkea to publish his own book, Artesia.
When you said his name, that popped in my brain, and so,
He started it. He had had Artesia at another publisher, and then had gotten the rights back. He wasn't really happy with what was going on there, or you know, kind of felt like he could do something on his own a little bit better. And then started up Arkea, and after a little while, he decided to open the doors to other creators, and I was in the first generation of that.
Yeah.
I was one of the first three books or four books that they welcomed in.
Okay. Had you ever published anything before that?
No.
Okay, so then Miles Guard was your first comic then, huh?
Yes.
That's pretty awesome. You know, talk about like hit it out of the park on your first shot, you know?
Thanks. Yeah, I mean, I look back and I see all the flaws in that first issue, where everybody else is very kind and says, "Oh, you did such a good job, you hit it out of the park." But I see all the problems.
Yeah.
So to me, it doesn't feel so much like a wow, what a amazing beginning. It's more like yeah, you know, it was good enough to let you in.
Get you going.
Yeah, we got you. You know, you're into the club now. We'll get you past the maitre d'. I don't know if you have a table yet. But you get to come in.
Right. I mean, when you started, and you know, I was buying the first Mouse Guards out of the comic shop. So it was back when I was kind of really going to comic shops and stuff. I mean, it had to be back kind of before this whole web comics thing has kind of started up. Would that be right?
Yeah, I suppose. I mean, there must have been webcomics going around at the time. Yeah. But yeah, probably nothing. Not like now. It wasn't as prominent as now. Yeah, I started publishing with Archaea in 2006. Issue through them.
Yeah, it was definitely before I was hearing about them. And so kind of like, I mean, back then, you know, like guys who were self-publishing, like Bone, Cerebus.
Yeah.
Or maybe it was a little bit late for them even. But so I can easily see why you wouldn't want to mess around going that direction, because that's probably a tough road to hoe.
Yeah, I mean, I self-published the first issue.
You did actually self-publish the first issue?
Self-published, well, but all that really means is that I just went to an on-demand... or, you know, print-on-demand publisher and or printer and sent them the files and said, hey, print these. And I paid, you know, $1.50 per issue that I printed and then was able to sell them for $3 at conventions. I had a couple retail owners saying, like, oh, we'd love to stock your book. We'll pay you $1 per issue.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, yeah, except I paid $1.50 per issue to print these. And the reason was because I was using a print-on-demand.
Mm-hmm.
And that's part of the problem with self-publishing is it's a trick. You have to get to the point where you have a high enough threshold, a high enough volume of sales that you can go to a real printer and print, you know, 2,000, 3,000 issues.
Yeah.
And to come out of the gate as an unknown and have those kind of quantities is really tricky. You know, I printed 250 of my first Mouse Guard issue. And I sold out of them, but you know that's a long way away from 2,000.
Yeah, absolutely. So that's pretty impressive, though. Sell 250 just off of print on demand. I mean, were you going just off your site or cons or what?
It was pretty much just conventions and people that I knew online from various drawing message boards.
Mm. So you were like online a long time ago, working this whole thing. I can see that.
You're
talking
bit.
About a message
little.
Boards and stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I wasn't doing it in quite the self-sustaining, marketing, self-promotion kind of way that you'll see people do it now.
Uh-huh.
And it's not like I was taking high road or anything like that. I just didn't really, I wasn't smart enough to be doing that.
Well, you know, let's see, so... I mean, as long as we're talking about Artesia, why don't we just go on talking about them? You know, I was doing a little research on you right before you called in and clicking around here and there. And one thing I noticed, like, when I typed in Mouse Guard, right in the, you know, like the paid Google advertising, came up Walmart was carrying your books and also Barnes & Noble and, you know, of course, Amazon. But then when I clicked over to Barnes & Noble, the first thing that kind of caught my eye was no edition for, like, the Nook. And I went looking on the Kindle, the same thing, no ebooks. Why not?
That's a good question. I don't completely know the answer to that.
Mm.
You know, there's so much business that needs to get dealt with in terms of who has rights to what and who have we already signed contracts with and how does that affect things that... I'm so focused on making new books that sometimes I lose sight of what has and hasn't been done on the digital front. I have no problem with those things existing. So it's not a moral issue of me saying no digital.
Right.
It just hasn't happened yet.
Yeah. Do you ever feel like? I mean, like I said, you know, going and self-publishing back in the day and, like, dealing with Diamond and everything, you're really kind of behind the eight ball. I'm kind of, you know, amazed that anybody like Jeff Smith or Dave Sim or any of those guys could make it work back then. But, you know, now it's a different game, you know, with online and everything. I mean,
sure.
Do you ever feel like, you know, maybe it's almost... this isn't a real loaded question, but you know, I hope you don't take it that way. But I mean, do you ever feel like maybe like the time of being published by somebody like Artesia has kind of passed, and maybe it's time for you to, you know, take their cut?
I mean, I see that there are a lot of new opportunities out there. I think people are figuring out how all that stuff's working,
mm-hmm.
and how it's panning out. I am jealous of some new creators, especially the ones who will sit out there and complain about how they can't get a deal or they're worried about trying to get their work shown to a publisher, and the publisher just isn't responding or isn't paying attention. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, you guys have so many opportunities, you don't even understand.
Yeah.
Like, you could print this on demand. You could print this, you know, through your site. You could self-publish. Like, there are lots of options that weren't even there, you know, just when I started.
Yeah,
but
absolutely.
Obviously, there's a benefit that comes with, you know, being with a publisher, and so, you know, that's working for me right now.
Yeah, absolutely. Obviously, it is. As far as I guess back to your writing, I'll just jump back because I kind of missed out. But like, you know, I mean, are you influenced by anybody? I mean, did you, you know, grow up like reading anybody that kind of like. You know, like, what was the kind of impetus for, like, starting Mouse Guard? I mean, what was, like, the original idea, and did anybody influence that?
Not when it comes to writers. I was actually a terrible reader as a kid. Mm-hmm. And not so much that I was a bad reader. I mean, I read slowly. But when I say a bad reader, I mean, I didn't keep up with it. While there were kids who would read for leisure, that just wasn't something that was in my... my day to day. There was no way I was just going to read a book because. And so I didn't really get influenced too much by books in that way. I was influenced by movies, television, and role playing games. So yeah. Mouse Guard kind of came about. Yeah, in high school, I wanted to do a story. We were all kind of doing our own comics, and I thought. One guy was doing something that was set in the modern world. Another guy was doing a sci-fi, Star Wars-y kind of thing. And I thought, okay, well, I'll do mine medieval.
Yeah.
And then we'll round out our catalog pretty nicely. And that was my kind of storytelling anyways. And I wanted to make it like Disney's Robin Hood.
Yeah.
And some of our Dungeons & Dragons campaigns.
Okay.
So that's where it started, except the animals were definitely more Disney's Robin Hood style. Human proportions with animal attributes for the heads and hands and tails and stuff.
Yeah.
In college, I decided it would be more interesting to make it more like Wind in the Willows or Aesop's Fables, where the animals are more animal than people.
Mm-hmm.
And even going to the point where I just said, no, they're just straight up animals. I'll only give them enough human attributes to be able to do things like wield weapons or whatever. But I need to keep all the correct size. I need to keep the predator-prey relationships. And I worried about if I was going to do that, how do I keep the mice, or how do I keep smaller animals alive when you've got, you know, big predators. Like, they're not going to be able to be friends anymore. These are going to have to be, like, weird little isolationist groups.
Yeah.
And I thought, well, the smallest thing I would put in the world would be a mouse, and the largest would be a bear. I gotta figure out how I'm going to keep these mice alive. And started working on their culture. And while I was working on their culture, the whole idea of the Mouse Guard and what it represents and all that stuff came out.
Yeah, that's interesting, and I mean, I think that's one of the big things I really dig about Mouse Guard is you know, like you kind of described it really well, is like that animal world. You know, it all kind of works within the animal world, you know, much more than like you see a lot of other, I guess, I don't know, what do you call them, anthropomorphic type situations where, like you said, the bears and the mice and the rabbits are all friends or something.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wanted it to be. There was also there's a children's book series called Redwall that a lot of people assume that I was. Mm-hmm. By, and in truth I was kind of counter-influenced by it, because a friend of mine said, oh, you know, you're writing this story about mice, you would love this book, and Redwall was doing almost all the things I wanted to do with Mouse Guard.
Right.
And so I went, oh darn, somebody else is already doing this and they're doing it better than I would have. So I shelved Mouse Guard for a number of years.
Oh really, just because of that?
Yeah. And then decided not to kind of pull it down off the shelf until, one, I was ready. Because I don't think at the time that I was starting to design Mouse Guard stuff, I really, I was at all ready. I was college student. You know, I hadn't had that many experiences. I didn't have a job, all kinds of stuff. So I wouldn't have been able to devote the amount of time and skill and all that to Mouse Guard that I needed to. And then when I pulled it off the shelf, I said, I gotta make sure that I'm going in a different route and come up with some really definitive differences between what Brian Jakes did and what I'm going to be doing.
Yeah. Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, and I'm glad you did, you know, come back with your idea, because I think there's definitely room for both. They're quite different, in my opinion. You kind of talked about role-playing, though, as being like an influence. And I noticed that you have a role-playing game out now. Did you did you do that yourself, or did you have guys, like a company, do that for you? Or?
It was a single guy. I mean, like I said, a lot of the influences in the writing and the kind of stories were based on adventures that I had had while role-playing with friends. Mm-hmm. And some of the characters are based on friends. So I don't think there were more than just a couple issues of the comic out before fans started to ask, is this a role-playing game?
Yeah.
Which I thought was really interesting, that they already saw those role-playing influences in at the very beginning. And so I knew that there was fan interest. The longer the series went, there was more of that kind of talk. And I ended up meeting up with Luke Crane, who wrote the Mouse Guard RPG. We were at a convention and we were discussing game design just in general.
Yeah.
He did not even really know that he was up for the possibility of the job at the time. And it just worked out. By the end, I said, hey, I think I'd like to work with you, and gave him my contact info, and we went from there. I've done a little bit of game design on my own. I've tried making my own role-playing games, and I've even made a couple board games.
Yeah.
And I knew just enough about game design to know that I should not attempt the Mouse Guard role-playing game myself.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Yeah, that it's too much. Also, Mark Smiley had done his own Artesia role-playing game, and I knew that it had almost killed him and took, I don't even know how long, but it was, you know, something like a year and a half or 2 years away from him working on his comic.
Oh my God.
Yeah, and I just thought, I don't want to sacrifice that kind of time, especially when I don't even know that I'm that good at writing role-playing games and coming up with rules and stuff and not having loopholes. And
yeah.
And that's what Luke does for a living, so I'd rather put it in the hands of someone that I trust, that I can still feel like I'm a partner with, because Luke was definitely open to collaborating. You know, we had a couple broad discussions about games and what we liked and didn't like in games, and then we had a couple specific conversations about Mouse Guard.
Yeah.
And what a Mouse Guard role-playing game should be. And it came down to stuff like, I said, I don't want to go too crunchy on the role-playing side where you're having to calculate the weight of what you're carrying, but ultimately it ticks me off in role-playing games where you just keep accumulating stuff and you're carrying around, you know, thousands of gold coins and 200 arrows and a
yeah.
cooking pot and a cot and a warm wool blanket and a chipped sail and treasure chest and three swords, and you're like, how does this guy run when it comes to nobody ever calls it into question, you know? And the only way to do that is you really have to be a nitpicker on how much weight.
Yeah.
I said, I want to solve that problem with Mouse Guard, because the mice really travel light.
Yeah.
And I think we should have some kind of mechanic built in. What I would like to do is do something like, you're only allowed to carry three items.
Yeah.
And even though someone could abuse that and carry three really big items and still be able to be just as mobile as a small one, because there's no other mechanic for it, it at least puts people in the right mindset. Just telling them you can only carry three things, I think, already gets them going in that direction. He said, well, I think three is too small, you know, it's not enough. But he said, why don't we just make an area on the character sheet that's for their inventory, and when that's full, they're full.
Yeah.
And we talked about the pros and cons of that someone could abuse that and write really small.
Yeah.
And we ultimately decided that that's up to that person and their role-playing group. You know, they can break the rules no matter what anyways. You know, we could say, oh, there's only three lines. And all it takes is the person to say, oh, I'm going to write my inventory over here on this notepad. So they're going to break the rules, and as long as it's okay with their gaming group, we can't stop them.
Yeah.
We can put the idea in their head, and that was a collaborative, you know, like, that was a nice collaborative chat. It wasn't me saying, hey, I think we should do it this way, and Luke going, no, we can't. You can get a nice discussion about what the pros and cons were of each approach, and what would be the simplest, most economical way to get it solved.
Yeah. Do you play it now that it's made yourself with your friends?
No, I play tested it once, with Luke, but no, I just don't have the time to sit down and role play. I wish I did.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, how much? That's a good point to bring up. Is like your schedule just as a working artist? I mean, how many hours do you draw every day?
I don't even know. Like, I don't even keep track of it. I kind of feel like, pretty much every day I'm working at least 12 hours a day, if not more. That's not always drawing or coloring or inking. Sometimes that's emailing. Sometimes that's writing. Sometimes that's self-promotion type stuff, getting things ready for conventions. We've got the online store.
Yeah.
So fulfilling orders, making sure that stuff's all set. Got the Legends of the Guard series where other artists do Mouse Guard stories, so coordinating with other artists, making sure everybody's where they're supposed to be.
Whether
it's drawing or business or writing or coloring or whatever, I'm doing something Mouse Guard probably 7 days a week, 10 hours a day.
Right. You mentioned your store and fulfilling orders. I mean, you take care of all that yourself? You take all the orders yourself and package them and shove them out the door?
My wife does the lion's share of that work. She does almost all of it. There's a little bit here and there where I have to coordinate with her, and you know, we have to go over what has to ship out or how something has to ship, or I have to sometimes sign or personalize some of the items.
Yeah.
Stuff like that. But I'm very lucky that she does most of that. I don't have to worry about as much of it. But even some of the store maintenance, you know, I'm updating some of that. She's updating some of that. That really just comes into whoever's closest to a computer at the time that something is happening and needs to get done.
Yeah. Do you guys do your own website then and everything? I mean, especially with the store. Okay.
Yep.
Are you running your store through any kind of like Shopify or something, or did you just do
Big
Cartel? I'm sorry, what?
Big Cartel.
Oh, Big Cartel. Okay. Yeah. That's a good one. I've heard of that one.
Yeah, it looked around it. I mean, I had a friend of mine in an Ann Arbor-based company do the do my actual website called Build Create, and they did a great job. But then I asked them to look into various store implementations that could be put onto my site. And partly, some of it came down to the specifics that I needed for an online store, dealing in a lot of one-of-a-kinds.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, once a piece of artwork is sold, it's gone, so I have to have special rules about if there's only one thing and who actually got to it first, and do you have to pay for it first, or does it time out like theater tickets in a shopping cart, or what? And so while we were going back and forth about what kind of options were available and how much it would cost to have them custom code, I saw a friend using a Big Cartel and asked them how that was going for their original art sales, and they said it was great. We've had a few hiccups, but for the most part, it works really well.
Right. I mean, you know, I sell stuff on my store, and, you know, I get overwhelmed with just the amount of shipping I have to do. I mean, I would think, like, you, where you're like, semi-famous in the comic book world, I mean, you must just get tons of stuff. I mean, I'm kind of amazed that you can handle it all yourself.
Yeah, well, like I said, most of it's my wife. There was a point... there was
my
a
wife
point
helps me, too, but, you know, it's like, it's still a lot. I said, my wife helps me, too, but, I mean, it's still a lot, you know?
Yeah, oh, yeah, it's definitely a lot of work. Yeah, I mean, she's, in fact, I don't know if every now and then you hear the crackle of tape. She's she just ran upstairs to let the dog out right now, but like 2 minutes ago she was sitting over at the work table down here getting getting some orders packaged up.
It's going to town,
so, yeah, at least, you know, at least once a day she's packing something up.
Yeah.
Oh, but it's awesome. it's a good source of extra income, and it also it relieves a situation that we've had, or a couple situations. One is fans who can't get out to conventions. Mm-hmm. They'll say, "Oh, we really want to get that item, but I don't live near any convention, and there's just no way I'm gonna make it out to one."
Yeah.
Now I can do that, and then there's also the issue of flipping. People getting things for me at a convention and then putting it up on eBay, you know, before I can even get home.
Right.
So stuff that I just sold at Emerald City last weekend is now already up on eBay.
Yeah.
And we're not having, you know, that's fine. But what's nice is I have a nice counterbalance. So the fans who actually follow me regularly, see what I've tweeted, see what I'm posting on Facebook, follow the blog, they know that they shouldn't overpay on eBay for something that I'll probably be putting up in my store, or I've already told them I'm going to put up in my store when I get home.
Right, right.
So it's a nice thing to do for my fans where I feel like they're not being taken advantage of.
Yeah.
There's not them not to be.
Right. Even these guys flipping on eBay, though, I mean, that's, they're still kind of initially paying you, so in a way, it's like, can't be all bad there, huh?
Right, yeah. I mean, the only thing I have a problem with there is some of the flippers who are being dishonest. And like I said, the fans who can't get out to conventions, mm-hmm. then are being charged a huge premium.
I see.
And I would rather charge them the regular rate, get paid less, but be honest about it. Like, I'm not overcharging them. That item isn't worth $50. It's worth, right. You know, charging them $50 just because you know that they're stuck in BFE doesn't mean that you get to, you know, overcharge them. And then the dishonest part that I was having the biggest problem with was it usually happened with my sketchbooks.
Yeah.
I would have a sketchbook come out at San Diego. That's where I released them. And every year, no matter what volume, you know, I was being careful about how many I was printing, but whatever it was that I printed, I knew that I'd actually end up bringing about half of them home with me.
Yeah.
So when I was printing about 300, I knew 150 of those were going to come back home, and I'd take them to the rest of my conventions, and I'd offer them in my store or whatever, or even before a store, I'd just take them to the rest of my conventions. And I'd see people on eBay putting them up saying that I had sold out.
Oh, I see.
That was it, that those were the only ones left. And I know that even just trying to get the fans to hear me amongst all the other creators and blogs and sites that they are following, you know, I would tell them, hey, I know it's going to seem bad that I'm only taking 300 sketchbooks to San Diego, but trust me, I'll have books left after the show. And they'd say, no, that's so not fair. You're going to run out. And sure enough, I'd bring home half and I'd put them on. But because they already had that panicked mentality, and then somebody lied in their listing on eBay, now someone's getting charged $60 for that item that I would charge them $24.
Right.
And ultimately, it's also taking $20 out of my pocket, because now that I have an online store, I could have sold it to that person for $20.
Right.
And because you lied and made them think that they wouldn't have any other chance to get it, they paid you $60.
Right. So it kind of becomes a competition with you. Yeah. How about that? You know, you kind of said, you know, trying to, like, get in touch with the fans and all that kind of stuff. I mean, you know, do you do all the Facebook and the Twitter and all that kind of stuff? I mean, I'm only really familiar with your blog, but...
Yeah, I do Facebook and Twitter and the blog. I don't do too many updates to the website. In fact, I think right now the website is kind of painfully out of date. It doesn't have information about the latest couple releases. And that's kind of how I see it. The website is meant to be there as more of a static, long-term, you know, here's what MouseGuard is if you've never heard of it.
Right.
And then Facebook and Twitter serve the day-to-day, I need to get a quick update out, I want to share something that's going on quickly, you know, hey, I'm still alive.
Yeah.
It's been a while, but I'm still alive. And then the blog is where I can kind of balance the two and go a little bit deeper with what I'm going to be talking about. I can go through some process or whatever.
Yeah.
but it still comes out once a week.
Yeah, it's a great blog. I love it. So, like in your store, I mean, in your online presence, I mean, your books are just sitting in your store, and they're like there all the time and available. And you know, like in the comic shops, they go in and they go out, right? And there's times when they're probably not that available. I mean, do you think? I mean, are you getting?
I don't tend to sell books through the website, part of that's because I don't want to compete with retailers.
Okay.
Or Diamond, because if I offer books that are signed through my store, I'm taking away confidence from other retailers and even booksellers like Barnes & Noble to stock my book, because the person can come get it directly from me, and I want those stores to have it. I want someone to be able to walk in and discover it.
Yeah.
Not just existing fans to be able to pick it up when it's convenient. So, I mean, every now and then, if I bring some books back from a convention and I've got a little extra that I'm trying to unload, yeah, I'll put them up in the store. But for the most part, the store is for items that you wouldn't be able to get through a regular retail store. Things like shirts, original art, sketchbooks and book plates, some things like that.
Yeah. But I mean, you know, by the same token, you know, like I said, you know, when I did a search, kind of looking around for you, you know, they were like on Amazon and in Barnes & Noble and places like that. You know, they're all kind of competing with Diamond in a way. Why do you have like kind of a, I don't know, like an issue with that in a way? You know what I mean? It's not like.
Well, they're ordering from.
They order from Diamond when they go into Barnes & Noble?
They order from Diamond as well.
Oh, okay.
Usually. I mean, there are a couple other book distributors, but ultimately they're getting the books in the hands of people who wouldn't otherwise find them. And I have to think that the books that Barnes & Noble is selling to people who just walk in are books that wouldn't sell out of a comic shop. The people who are going into a Barnes & Noble and discovering Mouse Guard for the first time and deciding to pick it up right then are probably people who would never walk into a comic shop, which is why they've never heard of Mouse Guard or hadn't already picked it up.
Yeah, definitely.
And I think there are lots of people who would walk into a Barnes & Noble, see a Mouse Guard book, if they're a comic book person, and say, oh, I wonder if my comic shop has this. I'm going to go buy it from my guy.
Mm-hmm.
Because they have some kind of setup at their store or whatever. So I don't really see them as competing. You know, I just see it as a wider awareness of getting the message out there that there are, you know, graphic novel kind of books.
Yeah,
I also think that, you know, the handwriting's on the wall that bookstores and comic shops are going to butt heads in some ways. And that the comic shop, what the comic shop has over over a Barnes & Noble is that they are specific and that they know the material. I've walked into bookstores when I've been in other towns, I've been out of town, and I'll walk into a store to see if they have my book or whatever, and I'll ask. And I've gone into Barnes & Nobles in Texas and said, do you have where's your graphic novel section? And they go, our what? they really don't even know what I'm talking about. And then they'll say, well, what other books would be in that kind of a section? Can you just list some titles that I might be familiar with? And I'd say things like, Mouse or Bone or Watchmen, Dark Knight Returns, you know, some pretty mainstream graphic novels.
Yeah.
And they still either don't know what I'm talking about or they take me over to a section that has, you know, 12 books on a shelf. And obviously, not all Barnes & Nobles are that bad. I'm not meaning to beat up on them, but
yeah.
Even at a Barnes & Noble, if you're an employee at Barnes & Noble, you have to know about a lot of different kinds of books, not just graphic novels. And so there's no way you can keep up with all of what's current and what people like. And I think comic shops, where they have it over, is that they are specific in that one area, and they should become kind of purveyors of good taste. They should be able to help someone, whether they're a long-time comic reader or a first-time comic reader, they should be able to help that person find a book.
Mm-hmm.
And not just a book that they know the name of, but if someone comes in and says, I've never really read comics. I mean, I really like shows like blah blah blah, you know, ABC, and I watch you know, or I read novels by this author, that author.
Yeah.
The comic shop owner should be able to put those interests, likes, and genres together and think, if they like zombies, if they like this, and then, oh, okay, Walking Dead's for you. Or if they like romance or whatever, find something that's more in the romantic side or the comedy side or whatever by figuring out those interests and you know how to recommend movies to a friend because right. You know their likes. That's what comic shops should be able to do with strangers who walk in and start up a conversation with them. And a Barnes & Noble isn't going to be able to do that just because of the sheer volume of everything they have to stock besides graphic novels.
Right. What do you think about, as far as the comic shops go, this whole idea that you hear online about kind of where print is going, which is, is it going online? Are books going away, or what's your take on that?
I don't think books will ever go away. I think, but I think that in an age where people are reading web comics for free, I'm seeing on my own statements from Archaea as digital sales are increasing. I mean, I remember the first time digital sales appeared on an account statement, and it was nothing. I mean, it almost didn't warrant its own line. It was so tiny.
Yeah.
And I've seen, you know, every quarter that doubles or triples to the point where you're going, okay, this is actually a substantial number now. Like, this is real money. This is real readership we're talking about. And in an age where that's happening, where I can attest to the fact that my books are being read digitally more than they were, by leaps and bounds, bookmakers have to concern themselves with making books objects you want to hold, and not just a physical folder for pages. It shouldn't just be a binder for the same content that you can get digitally. You need to think about paper content, the paper texture and quality and the binding and extras and things that you can do with books that you can't do digitally with gatefolds and stuff. Not to the point where it's getting gimmicky, but to the point where the book itself is something you want to own, something you'd be proud to own, something you want to put on a shelf, that you want to put out on your coffee table, that when friends come over you want to say, look at this, look at how beautiful this is.
Right.
And for a while, I think publishers were putting out collections as cheaply as they could. They were on crappy paper. They were put in paperback, and hardcovers were considered only, for the most celebrated of titles. Only when we do an absolute version of such and such beloved story run will it get a hardcover treatment. Mm-hmm. I think the hardcover route and making a book something that you want to spend an afternoon in a comfy chair with on a rainy day is the only way, or is the best chance we have to keep the book market thriving.
Yeah.
But I don't think it's really ever going to go away. I think people like owning things.
Yeah.
They just like things too much.
Yeah. And I get that. I mean, I love books, and I much prefer, a printed version of whatever, especially like an art book. But, by the same token, I kind of look down the road, and I see things like iTunes and music, and I think back on, tapes and CDs and that kind of thing. And is it necessarily important in a way to sort of keep books alive? With things like iTunes, where people are still buying music, but just not in the same form.
I think with the place that you're seeing digital, where it's taking over, are things like movies and music, where ultimately when you'd go to a store and buy a DVD or a VHS or a CD for your music or a record before a tape or a record, ultimately, that object was just a way of getting the material into your other senses.
Right.
There was nothing about holding the VHS clamshell or the CD jewel case that added anything to the experience. The only place that you can even kind of start to make that argument is with vinyl albums and the album cases and the album artwork and liner notes and stuff like that.
Right.
But for the most part, the experience of enjoying music is through your ears, and there's nothing about holding it that, you know, holding the vessel that it comes in as to adding to the experience. So yeah, when it comes to that, yeah, iTunes and all that kind of stuff is taking off because people don't want to have the other stuff.
Yeah.
I'm to a point where I don't have room for all the DVDs.
Yeah.
You know, and things are getting piled up on top of each other. And I've even stopped buying some movies at this point because I realize I probably would have access to it some other digital way than to owning it. It's not that I'm still willing to pay for the content. I'm not getting it for free, but I don't want to jam up more space in my cabinet for that stuff. But when it comes to books, I like digital in the sense that I can take it around with me. I can flip through it for quick reference. I can try something out that I've never tried before. Mm-hmm. And in that way, I think digital is going to take over when it comes to issues.
Right. Which is, you know, not so hot for comic shops.
Well, again, if the comic shops see themselves as the purveyors of good taste, they can still sell the hell out of books and collectibles and I think do well.
Yeah.
And I've heard some things about comic shops partnering with various digital outlets that if you mention such and such store as you're buying your digital version, the store gets a kickback.
Yeah.
And maybe some of that stuff needs to be explored. But ultimately, I need to hold that book. I want to hold a book if it's something I really like.
Yeah.
I mean, webcomics have already kind of proved this as a model. In that the successful webcomic people are people who put out the material for free.
Yeah.
It's a quick way of getting you the stuff. You can read it. You can you find out that you like it. You like that author or that artist's storytelling methods. You like the humor or you like the story. And even though you can go back and reread the whole thing from the beginning, the minute they put out a hardcover collection, you want to support it. And I think you want to support it for two reasons. One, you feel bad that you've been reading this material for free and you want to support the artists that you like. But I really think there's another big part of it that's you want to own and hold that thing so that you can take it to bed with you without having a laptop open or without having to go through an interface or whatever. You just get to hold the book.
Yeah.
And some of the artists who have done it really well, like Carl Kerschel with his Abominable Charles Christopher series, the hardcover for that series is phenomenal. It's got a beautiful book design. He put a lot of care into it, and I would much rather flip through that than click through the pages on his site.
Yeah. Do you read it online?
Yeah. Every week.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm pretty much with you. I really, you know, I'm a guy who has tons of books, and you know, there's no plans of stopping buying them. You know, I love books, and I honestly, you know, especially with art, I love to look at it, you know, printed so much more than on a screen for some reason. Are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here. Yeah,
okay,
yeah.
Sorry, it just went real quiet. Okay, so I guess kind of get down towards the end. How long do you plan on doing Mouse Guard?
I guess until I run out of stories or people don't want to hear them anymore.
Is there any kind of end story that you got in
mind?
No,
I don't have anything in mind for an end. I mean, I have specific ends for characters.
Mm-hmm.
And they might be sooner, they might be later. It's not like I know, oh, this character dies in the next book or something like that. It's just I know this is the character that's going to live to the end of their days, and I know how they die when that happens. And this character, okay, they might have a premature death or whatever. Mm. And I know about the offspring of some characters, and yeah, it can just keep going on. I mean, I've already done... I did two books set in the year of 1152. The prequel that I just finished is set within about a year and a half's worth of time and kind of only deals with two main characters. And then the next series that I'll do after Black Axe will be another prequel that'll take place just a couple years before fall. But I've got a lot of space beyond what I'm working right now. You know, I could go with stories that take place after the winter series. I could go with stuff that happened between Black Axe and Fall, or Black Axe and the Weasel War. I've got a lot of room to play, even with just these characters, without even getting to the end of my rope with their natural life cycles.
Yeah, that's really cool. Do like mainstream comics come along and give you a lot of offers?
No. Nope.
Not so much, yeah.
There have been a couple times where somebody who works at one of those mainstream companies but doesn't have the power to hire me will say, oh, yeah, I think we can get you a job doing an X-Men backup story or something like that, and then nothing.
Yeah.
And it's fine. I mean, I'm as cool as it would be, at the same time, I've got more than enough work on Mouse Guard.
Right. So you would...
This is the best kind of work.
Right. You'd actually be interested in something like an X-Men story? I mean, that kind of surprises me.
Yeah, I mean, if it was the right length and I wasn't clamped down too much editorially, why not? It's a series that I really enjoyed when I was reading mainstream comics. It's a huge push in terms of visibility and getting people who might not otherwise see my work to see my work.
Yeah.
And as long as it's a one-time short turnaround thing, it's just a nice change of pace.
Yeah.
I've done some covers for different companies. I did a bunch of Muppet covers, and I've done Ninja Turtle covers, and same kind of thing. It's nice to get new people looking at my work. It's nice for me to do something different, and with both of those, I had a particular affinity for the characters and the original creations themselves.
Yeah, those Muppet covers are great. I also love that Dark Crystal. I don't know if that was a cover or not. Was that for the comic?
It was a pinup that it was used to announce the partnership between Arkea and Henson.
Yeah.
And then there was talk that I might have been doing something on the interior of that book, but it didn't work into my schedule, and it ended up being just a pinup that's used in the hardcover, the first Dark Crystal hardcover.
Yeah, that was really cool. Were you like a Henson fan? You were kind of saying an affinity for...
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Definitely. There was a point during college where I really thought I was going to quit school and then try to go work at Henson.
That's really cool. Yeah, that's awesome.
When we were doing our various movies and stuff like that in middle school and high school, a lot of it came down to, we couldn't do big creature effects and things like that, but I could build puppets and I could build costumes and those type of effects. So I already had some homemade training, and by that point I had a sculpture class or two with mold making and casting under my belt, and thought, I don't really know that a full art degree is going to do me any good. Should I really transfer out of this 2-year program into a 4-year program, or should I just go do something? And so I toyed with the idea of trying to go get a job with Henson.
Yeah.
I ended up not. I decided I was too scared and would just stay at home and keep going to school.
Yeah. How long did it...
Real desire.
Right. How long did it take you, like, from college till you kind of got going with Mouse Guard?
I graduated in 2000 and then wrote and drew the first issue in 2004, late 2004, early 2005. And then hooked up with Arkea in 2006.
So not that long.
So I mean, it felt kind of long, but not terribly. And really, when you look at the amount of time that I spent working on something, not very long at all.
Right.
So it was only a couple of years that I was going on different forums and web boards and stuff and showing off my work and that kind of thing. Before that, I was just goofing off. I wasn't trying to get work. I was just trying to pay my rent with the jobs that I had, working at a coffee shop or an antique store.
Right. I mean, I imagine when you get picked up by Arkea, or even self-publishing your own work, you're not immediately probably making a living at it, or are you?
No, not at all.
It took a while for,
Yeah, it took a while. I mean, I probably could have quit the day job a little sooner than I did, but we owned a home by that point, wife and I, and had a mortgage payment that we were making due to both my job and hers, and the idea of quitting to go into something like comics where yeah, the money's good right now, but what does it look like a year down the line? I wasn't willing to give up the good paying job, or at least the steady paying job with benefits, to find out. So I waited until I was definitely on good steady ground where we knew this was going to be the routine for a while. And also when conventions that were bringing in good money were proving to be a problem for me to go to because of work schedules.
Okay. So these conventions, I mean, how much was it, like, as far as your income is off of the books compared to, like, what you're making off, like, going to conventions and commissions and all that kind of stuff? I mean, was it, I mean, could you have done it without the commissions, or did that step in and kind of, like, bump you guys up?
I mean, it makes a difference. You know, every little bit helps.
Mm-hmm. And,
you know, right now I've got income from publishing. I've got income from commissions, from convention sales, lots of stuff.
Yeah.
You know? And so that's it, all of that working together is what gives me the freedom to take as long to work on a book as I do.
Right. Yeah. Well, okay. That's awesome. I guess that's all. Be careful of that the making the models and stuff. Your next thing you want to do, you might end up making the animated Mouse Guard movie, and then we'll never hear from you again.
I think just like the role-playing game, I've done just enough animation on my own to know that I'm not going to do any Mouse Guard animation on my own.
Okay. No, it was a real pleasure. I mean, I love the book, and you know, you were a great guest, so thanks a bunch.
Thank you very much, and I'm sorry about the technical difficulties there.
No problem. Thanks for scheduling it in and everything. So I'll see you later, David.
All right.
Bye.
That was a great interview. I'd like to thank David for coming on. And any of you guys that listen that think it's think it was a great interview too, you know, wouldn't hurt, you know, if you go by his site and tell him thanks yourself. That would I'm sure make him happy. And you know, he made some great points about, a lot of different things. I've been reading Mouse Guard, like I said, for quite a while, probably since the beginning. I was, picking it up in the comic shops. I wasn't going back as far as the self-published stuff he was talking about, but definitely all the issues from Archaea. And like I said in the interview, I kind of lost track of it when I stopped kind of going in the comic shops, you know, and didn't really find him again until I saw his blog on the web, and you know, it's a pretty cool blog. And that was one of the reasons I want to get him on here, because he seems to be kind of a one of these creators that's straddling both sides of the whole internet and print kind of chasm. And some of the stuff that he said, you know, in the interview, business-wise, that I think, you know, was super interesting was him talking about his store and also selling originals and also making his money in a lot of different places. I know back when I did comics a long, long time ago, you know, if I wouldn't have sold originals, it'd have been really hard to make enough to make a full living doing comics. And that was back in, you know, the heyday of the 90s when everybody was supposed to be just like bleeding money or something. And it just kind of goes to show, you know, that, you know, it just doesn't really matter. I mean, whatever your situation, it's a good idea to kind of set yourself up in a way that, you know, when one thing goes away, you have other things to kind of keep you propped up, and so you don't just go out of business, you know. I mean, if you're one deal is doing comics or published work or you know, basically being an employee for someone else. Not that that's how David is, but you know, if you're just working for comics, it's a good idea to capitalize on that and spread out your base, you know, while you got the chance, while you have the name and the sort of the fame to make that, like I said, just kind of like a big base. So like when one of those legs gets cut off, you know, you're still standing, you know. So, you know, like, for example, David, you know, he's selling stuff in his store. He's selling originals. And then plus he's working for other people, and plus he's got a comic, you know. And he's got a strong base, and it's like a no wonder that he can make it, you know. I also thought it was interesting that he also has his wife helping him ship stuff, you know. It's not that different than what I do. And let's see. I mean, the only thing that kind of surprised me was his attitude towards these guys selling stuff on eBay. And I've ran into that a couple of different times with Adam Hughes, actually. You know, Adam Hughes has like kind of a real dislike for guys that buy his stuff at conventions and then go sell it on eBay. And I kind of got a little bit of a better perspective, I think, talking to David, because I didn't really think about like the fact that, you know, they could be kind of racing you to sell to your own customers. But by the same token, I don't know. I mean, I remember, you know, listening to Adam Hughes talk about these guys buying stuff at conventions to just turn around and just sell it on eBay, like, immediately. And, you know, he kind of went so far as to tell some of his customers, like, you know, that he was, when he was selling original art to him, to like, hey, if you're ever going to sell it, you know, bring it back here and sell it back to me. And that, you know, kind of, you know, I mean, it's just, as a guy who sells art, you know, it's like, I don't want it back, you know what I mean? I don't, you know, if somebody gets tired of it from, at some point, and they put it on eBay, I honestly hope they sell it for more money, because I really, you know, hope that the investment has, you know, grown along with, you know, however I grow, so that when they sell it, it actually does make them a lot more money. So I don't know. I mean, I have a hard time kind of understanding it, even after David kind of said it. And everybody's got their opinions, and, you know, there's probably no right or wrong in this whole thing. But anyway, I just want to thank David again for taking the time to talk to me, coming on the show. I think that, you know, he had a lot of valuable stuff for me and for all the listeners. So thanks a lot, David. And thanks to everybody who's who watched. And don't forget about Mad Max. Share my videos on Facebook. Enter in. And you can enter as many times as you want. So every time I'm seeing a guy like my thing on Facebook or liking it on Twitter or, you know, posting in on the new video or whatever, I just write their name again into my list of people that are going to go into the hat. So, I mean, you could literally, you know, if you want to enter 100 times and share my stuff 100 times, go for it. You know, you're just helping me out. And I'll definitely, you know, I'll write your name down 100 times and put it in there. So thanks a lot. Next week I got another great show for you guys. So I'll see you next time. Thank you.